welcome to a new edition of Cairo Local Time. In today's episode, we'll bring you the latest news and reports on ongoing activities here in Egypt. Stay tuned, we'll be back after the break. Welcome back, and we start off with some local news. And President Fattah el-Sisi inaugurated the renovated Museum of Islamic Art on Wednesday. A documentary was played on the history of the museum and renovation work. A terrorist attack on Cairo police headquarters in 2014 had caused huge damage to the nearby museum. The Museum of Islamic Art is considered one of the greatest in the world, with its exceptional collection of rare woodwork and artifacts, as well as metal, ceramic, glass, crystal, and textile objects of all periods and from all over the Islamic world. It houses more than 100,000 objects, and its collection includes rare manuscripts of the Quran with some calligraphy written in silver ink. And to shed more light on the importance of the museum, we are joined over the phone with Mr. Mohammed Hosni. He is a researcher in Islamic heritage. He will tell us more about the importance of the museum, when it was built, and who built it. Good afternoon, sir. Good afternoon, Mr. Mohammed.
Yes.
We were talking, Mr. Mohammed, about the importance of the museum of Islamic art, which was inaugurated yesterday by His Excellency President Fattah el-Sisi. First, would like you to shed more light on the importance of this museum.
Okay, the Islamic Museum in Cairo is the largest Islamic art museum in the world. It started in the days of Khedive Ismail in the 1880s. It started with a very small collection that was housed in the Mosque of Al-Hakim in the Azhar area, and it started with a mere small collection of 111 pieces. This collection, over the years, purchases, donations, collections from different Islamic sites in Cairo, grew to the size of 100,000 pieces. And as such, it is considered one of the most, if not the most, important collection of Islamic art and artifact in the world. It started in the days of Khedive Ismail as a museum of Arab art. They called it the Museum of Arab Art. But with time, Zaki Hassan, the famous antiquity expert, changed its name from merely Arab art to Islamic art, because the collection became so rich that it came from all over the Islamic world, not merely the Arab countries. So it came as far as China, India, Persia, and in the West, all the way from Andalusia. So it did not become only an Arab collection, it became the richest Islamic collection in the world.
So, sir, how can we promote for this important museum abroad, and what kind of tourists is interested in these kinds of museums?
Okay, let me reiterate what I said in your program previously, or on your channel previously, that one of the great misconceptions that we all grew up with is that Egypt should be only proud of its pharaonic past.
Yes.
This is true, but it's true in the sense that we should be proud of our pharaonic past. But we should not only be proud of our pharaonic past, we should be equally as well proud of our Greco-Roman, our Coptic, and our Islamic past, all the way to the time of the royalty. We should be proud of all these periods, because they all left us with a heritage that is so wealthy, that is so rich, that is so impressive, that it is really worth being proud of.
Okay, Mr. Mohammed.
And as such, let me come back to your question. And as such, we should not only promote Egypt as a place for pharaonic sites, we should also publicize and market Egypt as a center of excellence in Islamic art, in Coptic art, in Greco-Roman art, and so on and so forth.
Okay, Mr. Mohammed Hossi, researcher in Islamic heritage, thank you for being with us, sir.
You're welcome.
And back to our local news, and the Parliament Legislative Committee passed amendment on the protest law. Head of the committee, Bahaeldin Abu Shoka, said that the bill falls in line with the verdict issued by the State Constitutional Court last December. He noted that the amendment guarantees the right of peaceful protesting, and a harmony has been created between citizens and executive power when it comes to protesting. More in the following report.
The Parliament legislated a bill to amend Article 10 of the protest law. Committee Chairman Bahaeldin Abu Shoka said that draft law on the amendment comes in line with the Constitutional Court ruling on the 3rd of December 2016. Egypt's Supreme Constitutional Court struck down Article 10 of the protest law that allowed security authorities to ban all protests except those officially sanctioned. The 2013 law required demonstrators to inform the Interior Ministry that they were planning a protest. The Ministry could then refuse permission. The Supreme Constitutional Court ruled that the article was unconstitutional. The court said in a statement that the Constitution guarantees freedom of association and the right to peaceful protest. The approved amendment to the article places the fate of any protest in the hands of the judiciary instead of earlier provision of the law, which gave full authority to the Interior Ministry to ban any protests if they deemed them a threat to peace and security. Abu Shoka said the amendment guarantees the right to peaceful protest without any contradiction to Egyptians' constitutional rights. The bill with the amendment to the law is expected to be voted in the Parliament's general session.
And the Trade Minister, speaking from Davos, where he is attending the inauguration of the World Economic Forum, Tariq Kabil said that he will review investment opportunities in Egypt. Kabil told MENA correspondent in Switzerland that he will post world officials and representatives of big companies on steps taken to attract investments in Egypt. Kabil said he will be meeting with his Chinese counterpart on the sidelines of the event. The minister will also attend a meeting of 30 ministers representing the most influential countries at the World Trade Organization on Friday. He said that the meeting will focus on expected Chinese investments in Egypt as well as Russian investments at the industrial zone in Port Said. And the International Monetary Fund, IMF, officials said that Egypt's economic reform program will help in restoring macroeconomic stability while promoting sustainable growth. Meanwhile, the finance ministry announced that the goal of the program for 2016-2017 is to achieve a preliminary deficit of 0.8% of the GDP, which is the same target of the budget, which was approved by Parliament in June. More details in the following report.
Mission Chief for Egypt and Advisor to the International Monetary Fund's IMF Middle East and Central Asia Department, Chris Jarvis, discussed in a press briefing the details of the agreement between Egypt and the IMF in support of the Egyptian economic reform program adopted by the government. He expressed that the reform program will help Egypt restore macroeconomic stability while promoting sustainable growth. It also aims to correct external imbalances, restore competitiveness, place the budget deficit and public debt on a declining path, and create jobs while protecting lower-income citizens. On Wednesday, Finance Ministry announced in a press release that the goal of the program for 2016-2017 is to achieve a preliminary deficit of 0.8% of the GDP, which is the same target of the budget which was approved by the Parliament in June. Jarvis said that the IMF is well aware of the constitutional requirements and is glad the government is taking steps to achieve them and that the agreement matches the goals of the economic reform program. The Central Bank of Egypt decided to liberalize the pound. Jarvis stated that this decision will not only lead to improved competitiveness, but also increase attractiveness to foreign direct investments as well as help exports and tourism. He added that it will also give the CBE the chance to rebuild Egypt's international reserves.
And Egypt agrees with Uganda on tapping markets for Egyptian agro products in the African state. During a meeting with Ugandan Minister of Agriculture, Egyptian Minister of Agriculture Issam Fayed underlined the importance of promoting cooperation with Uganda in various domains, especially in the agricultural sector. In press statements following the meeting, Fayed said that the talks tackled means of increasing food imports and exports between the two countries. He said that talks addressed increasing livestock wealth alongside boosting small and medium-sized projects in the agricultural domain. He urged private sector to contribute to sustainable agricultural developments. And that was all for our local news. And now we'll go for some tourism news. And with the tourism magazine, which brings us some interesting news about attractive destinations in Egypt and the latest in archaeological discoveries. So stay tuned.
Bloomberg website chose Egypt among 20 tourist destinations worth visiting in 2017, saying that after years of political turmoil, the country was now ready to receive tourists. The report reads that if you want to get the pyramids all to yourself, now's the time to go to Egypt, which has shed its years of social and political unrest, but has yet to regain the crowds that long plagued its iconic sites. Geoffrey Kent, founder of luxury tour operator that is launching to itineraries in Egypt in 2017, said that locals are now more inclined to talk about their lives, hopes, and fears. He added that Egypt currently has better offers for tourists than ever before. The report added that several international companies inaugurated hotels in Egypt having tight security and safety procedures, and some Nile cruises between Luxor and Aswan were launched. In its report, the agency added that the Egyptian government opened the cemeteries of Queen Nefertiti and Pharaoh City I after years of closure due to renovation. According to Bloomberg, March is the best time of the year to visit Egypt due to relatively cheap offers. Shumo Art and Cultural Foundation hosted an exhibition of Egypt's late Queen Farida's artworks. 12th of January, Queen Farida, born Safinaz Zulfikar, was the first wife of Egypt's King Farouk from 1938 to 1948. She died in Cairo in 1988 after suffering leukemia. The exhibition will showcase 50 artworks by Queen Farida that went on display for the first time from what remains of her works that were partially stolen in the United States. Queen Farida's friend, the writer Lotus Abdel Hakim, wrote a book titled Farida, Art and the Crown that was recently published and would be available in signed copies at the exhibition's opening. The same day witnessed also the opening of Queen Farida Museum, founded by Abdel Hakim, which will house Farida's personal objects, as well as voice and video recordings and portraits of her by other artists. The exhibit included a library of books published by the monarchy about the royal family, which add up to 5,000 publications in both Arabic and foreign languages. The books and library are to be made available for interested researchers and scholars. Al Shuma Hall, where the exhibition took place, was founded by Abdul Karim and Queen Farida in 1986 and is reportedly one of the oldest private exhibition halls in Egypt.
Dear viewers, in this segment of our show, we are going to talk about an interesting issue, which is social system engineering. We'll try to know more about this social science and how can we use it to influence popular attitudes and social behaviors on a large scale. And to shed light on this issue, I joined here in the studio with the engineer, Dr. Ahmed Salah Rifqi. He is a social system engineer. Good morning.
Good morning.
First, I would like you to introduce to us what is meant by social system engineering.
Sure. Social system engineering,
yes.
It's a modeling, or it's we are structuring a social intelligent social system in order to solve the social problems from its roots. It's not only just given a painkillers. No, we are trying to solve them from the roots.
Yeah.
So for example, if you are talking about all the majority of the social problems, we can summarize it in three parts. It's with poverty or ignorance, or it's the illness. But actually, all those also they have root causes. So we take those problems and root causes. We take it. We modeling this problem into using the engineering science into modeling with equations and somehow like matrices, and we start to track the root causes, and we start to put some a key performance indicator for each problem, and we try to see how each one affecting the others. And then we try to take this problem, which is a problem, and we convert it into an opportunity for investment. For example, if we have a problem in a society, so it's a problem, it's the people there, it's very, they're angry about this problem. But if we find someone who's solving this problem, so we converted this problem into a solution, therefore it's an opportunity for investment. So this how that we are trying to make in solving the problem in a closed loop and from its roots.
So it's a personal question. Why did you choose to specialize in this field? As I know that you are an engineer.
Yeah.
True. So why did you choose this social system engineering?
Sure. Actually, this is a common question because my bachelor and my master degree, it's in mechatronics engineering.
Yes.
In the beginning, when I started mechatronics engineering, so the people telling, this is mechanics and electronics, why you integrate it together? So how it's coming? So it was very new. So so that's I like merging two sciences together.
Yes.
When it's come to in the revolutions, I have my friends. I am far away from the politics.
Yes.
But my friends were pro and co, so they start fighting together.
Yes.
So when I start to talk with them, I find that their problem is social problems.
Yes.
They have a problem in the low workforces salaries, or they have employment unemployment rates. And so I started learning, guys, your problem are social and not political.
Yes.
So later on, I start to leave the politics for them, and I start to work onto the social with the NGOs, the social problems and the social works.
Mm.
And I start to fight the poverty and the illness and the ignorance. Unfortunately, after 1 year, after I put a lot of investment, I found that the rates are increasing, not decreasing. So I find that I'm putting all my investment in painkillers. I'm not solving the problem from its roots. So I think, okay, so this is a social problem. And my background is engineering. So my background in engineering is solving industrial problems or problems in the
industry. You're more analytical.
Analytical. So why not converting these social problems into like an engineering problem and I start to solve it with my tools and my education and background.
Mm.
So this is the time that I merge the social science with the engineering.
Yes.
So that's why I the science is named social system engineering.
So you are the one who established
this
science for the first time. It's not found anywhere else in the world.
Yes, but during my because I had to study more about civilization, more about education, more about religions, more, because all those tools are motivating the people to work on this land and to motivate to increase their efficiency.
Yes.
Unfortunately, I found that I'm not the first one.
Yes.
I found that the priests of the Egyptian ancient Egyptians were the first social system engineers.
Yes.
Because they used the science, they used the religions, they used the media, they used the magic or the science into motivating the population to work on the land, to sacrifice this land and to work upon it very well. So I found this, they are the pioneers if we are talking about. So this is the pioneers, there, the beast.
So what are the types of social engineering, and tell us more about social structures?
Sure. It's one thing is important. When I am strong,
yes.
I don't want someone to help me.
Yes.
But when I'm weak, I need someone to help.
Yes.
So from the beginning of the civilization of making a community, we say that we need a third party, which is a community or a social system. I invest from my money and my time in it, because when I need it, I get it, like
yes.
the social affairs, like the medical insurance, a lot of things. The things that we are doing is we need to build or to re-engineer a social system is to manage intelligently with intelligence the resources, the human resources, and the resources of the land.
Yes.
So to do that, we do like a social system. Social system, it's we use it because it's on the pyramid shape. And why is the pyramid shape? Because it's very, very from the engineering point of view, it's very stable, the pyramid. And one of the things I return back to the civilization, we can find that Egyptians, it has into the kingdom of the civilization has during for 3,500 years and without any drops. And this is the longest civilization happened in the world. So when the Egyptian army has defeated, for example, the civilization continued. When they killed the king and the queen, the civilization continued. But when they enter and kill all the priests and their
yes.
sons and everything, the civilization has dropped because they was reading all the sciences of how making the structure into hieroglyphic, which is the population didn't understand. So this is the structure. It's like a building. If we are talking about like an building, we have 30 floors.
Yes.
In the first floor, when he opens the window, he can see only 50 meters ahead. But he can hear all the details in the street.
Yes.
But when we go up into the 30th floor or the 50th floor, he can see about for example, 15 kilometers.
Yes.
But he cannot hear all the details. So, for example, if in the higher or in the top floor there, he found a storm is coming,
yes.
and he tell guys in the first floor, close your windows because there is storm is coming. So, if there is no trust between them. The in the first floor, he tells them, no, I cannot see anything, so
yes.
I will not close the store. So this is the building of the trust to do a structure.
Yes.
If you are talking about the social structure, it's like a pyramid.
Yes.
On the top of the pyramid, it's very important to do a role models, to motivate the people to be that role models. The role model can be a king, can be a role model for each profession. And we're trying, this is our dream, we're trying to push all the population to be like him, like copy like him, because this is a dream, like a star. Or the second layer is coming with four powers, the education itself, the science, and the religion, and the media. Those four areas, they can motivate all, they take the role model and they start to teach the population how to become these role models through the media, through the education, so their work. Later on, we're coming with another layer. It doesn't mean that in the first layer is more important. No, they're all completing each other. The layers after, it's to make a social stability or with the law, with the thing and the security. And we need the security. It's not only the security on the ground. You're
yes.
taking with security. It's making the health security, the medicine security, the food security. So it's all about the security of the social system. It's all.
Yes.
And we return back with, for example, we return back on the ground. We can find the ground. It's the main mandover, the people working with their hand. And above is the professions that they use them to, or they integrate together to utilize the resources of the land. So this is a briefing about the social structure
yes.
that it can can work together as integrated. So each one serve each other.
So how do you apply all these studies on ground?
Okay, so let's tell you that the social system, any social system, is like a human being. All
yes.
we can take it from the Sphinx because we are Egyptians.
Yes.
We are, If we can see the Sphinx, it has a heart, it's a courage heart, and he has a mind of a human, and he has the force on the ground to do it. The social system is the same. Mm-hmm. So if you are talking with the modern solution, we have the heart is one man, we are following this one man, and the mind is the parliament, for example, and the muscles on the ground is the government that's motivated. If you are going to integrate this together, it's very important, and this is to integrate, because if there's a mind in direction and the heart in another direction and in the muscle in another direction, so there is no harmony on the ground. So it's very important to manipulate, to integrate all this together.
Yes.
And this is the social, this is one of the social dynamics inside.
Okay, so can you tell us about your achievements in this field?
Sure. As I told you that I work in the social works with a lot of NGOs, and usually we do the traditional works.
Yes.
For example, that if someone is poor, we give him money.
Yes.
If he needs water, we give him a connection of water.
These are the common ways. Solving problems.
Yes.
You are talking about the roots of the
problem
now.
Problems. So when we return back after 1 year, we find the poor, he's still poor. And
yes.
The ill, he's still ill. And everything. So and we start to find which is why he's poor.
Yes.
He's poor because he cannot find a job.
Mm.
So how he cannot find a job, and there is a lot of problems on his village. If he's working in any problem and he solves it, he's going to get repaid by the community.
Yes.
So we start to find the problems of the place. For example, one of the project we're taking about the man who's going to do fishing.
Yes, yes.
And we're taking those men, they cannot afford to buy new boots. So we bring them new boats. So one of the things
so
that
instead
he can
of giving him money you give him the boat.
Yes, and not give them the boat, buying the boat. No, we bring some people who doesn't they didn't find a job.
Yes.
And we tell them work for that, and those people is going to give you food.
Yes.
So it's like an integration. It's not with paper, with money exchange. You know, it's experience, and you give me a service, I give you a service. Later on, after we did that, we find that the people, when they get the fish, they have to sell it in
yes.
one day. It cannot stay to other days.
Yes.
So usually the buyers is come at 4 p.m. or 5 p.m. and knowing that if the man he didn't sell the fish, he's going to buy it with nothing because
yes.
the people is. So we bring them refrigerators. So the refrigerator,
yes.
they can take them and put it so they can get better price for the fishes. And later on, the refrigerator needs electricity. So how we can give an electricity? So we get more solar system.
Yes.
So this is an integration. So those people, my success, those people will not call me again. If they call me again, so it means that I failed. But if I did all the integrations and all them, they start to serve each other. So I did my job and they didn't call me again. So that means that they're fine.
So did you approach any government officials to cooperate with them in this field, or you depend on yourself and some NGOs in your work?
Actually, to do a sustainability
yes.
solution, you have a pyramid of three or a triangle of three parties. The government,
yes.
which gives you the authority to work, because
yes.
I work under the social affairs of the government. And with the private sector who can support you with the funds, and the NGOs who knows the real problem of the people. So the three should start together. Yes, of course, as NGOs, we are
yes.
not our role to do the infrastructure. But if anything fall apart or fall from the system, the
yes.
social system or the government, we
mm.
start to help.
Mm.
But it's not our role to lead.
So how do you get the funds for these projects?
Okay. The funds usually, this is traditional that the people, if you want to work into the NGOs, you
yes.
have to pay money. Yes, of course, yes, the money we can get it from our pocket,
yes.
but we don't serve mainly with our money. We serve with our experience, we serve with our time,
yes.
we serve with our heart at least. For example, if a doctor, we want to build a hospital.
Yes.
So why I'm going to buy a land and I'm going to buy a structure and buy equipment and hire doctors, and so I can use my connections and start Doctor, do you have some time to give me some consultation, and you can work, for example, one day for free, the other doctor has it. So we did this. We serve with our time and with our profession more than serving with our hand, and that's with our money. So the good success, for example, if we are delivering a water connection for a place, usually it costs us, for example, between 2,000 and 3,000 Egyptian pounds. But using our connections and using our profession and using our everything, we can get it less prices, because we start to, for example, 1,500 Egyptian pounds.
Yes.
Using, instead of getting workers from outside the village, no, I'm going to get workers from inside and teach them how to work. So I'm helping. And sometimes they're coming, for example, if I want to paint a school. Mm. Yes, I can pay money and get someone who's a painter. Mm. But if I found the students of the schools, if one of their father is a painter, so I tell him, why not you are going to paint, and your son, he was going be very, very proud of you if you paint this. We are going to give you all the equipment, and you pay it. So he tell me, yes, of course, why not? So I'm going to live at my son, and my son can see how I can improve his environment.
So finally, in 2 minutes, can you tell us about your future plans for this science?
Yes, of course. The point of my problem, my future of the science,
yes,
that I'm doing some activities in order to make some awareness about the science,
yes,
and to build a more familiarity to know the science, what it can do, and to have a very more positive opinion about the science, so the
yes,
people or the people in charge they can use it. And later on, to be, they consider my science or my idea into putting a strategic ways, and at the end to have the intention to use it. So this is a lot of activities or marketing activities that I'm working upon it. And currently, I'm publishing a book that
yes,
is going to be in the books affair. So I think this is might be a beginning to think.
So you are trying now to raise people's awareness about this science and to give courses to people to know more about them.
Yes.
So do you need more youths to be involved with you in your work, or you have enough now?
Actually, yes, but we need more integration. This is what
yes,
we are going to change that paradigm thinking about how to solve problems, because we don't want to always to come after a catastrophic
yes,
happens. We need to have a prevention,
yes,
prevention thinking. Not every time it's coming a problem, get as an expert to solve this problem. So no, we need the system, and we need a strategic thinking, so to solve any problem ahead, so it will not fall apart.
Okay, Engineer Dr. Ahmed Salah Rifqi, Social System Engineer, thank you for being with us.
Thank you so much.
And now, dear viewers, we'll go to see some technological news and the world of technology, and we'll see the latest in this field, so stay tuned.
Is the fourth generation of mobile phone communication standards. It is a successor of the 3G and provides ultra broadband internet access for mobile devices. The high data transfer rates make 4G networks suitable for use in USB wireless modems for laptops and even home internet access. 4G wireless is the term used to describe the fourth generation of wireless service. 4G is a step up from 3G, which is currently the most widespread high-speed wireless service. 4G is only available in limited areas in the world, but is now used widely in Egypt. While all 4G service is called 4G, the underlying technology is not the same. Sprint, for example, uses WiMAX technology for its 4G network, while Verizon Wireless uses a technology called long-term evolution, or LTE. No matter what technology is behind it, 4G wireless is designed to deliver speed. On average, 4G wireless is supposed to be anywhere from 4 to 10 times faster than today's 3G networks. Sprint says its 4G WiMAX network can offer download speeds that are 10 times faster than a 3G connection, with speeds that top out at 10 megabits per second. Verizon's LTE network, meanwhile, can deliver speeds between 5 Mbps and 12 Mbps. The 4G system was originally envisioned by the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency. The DARPA selected the distributed architecture, an end-to-end internet protocol, and believed at an early stage in peer-to-peer networking, in which every mobile device would be both a transceiver and a router for other devices in the network, eliminating the spoke-and-hub weakness of 2G and 3G cellular systems. Since the 2.5G GPRS system, cellular systems have provided dual infrastructures, packet switch nodes for data services, and circuit switch nodes for voice calls. In 4G systems, the circuit switched infrastructure is abandoned and only a packet switch network is provided, while 2.5G and 3G systems require both packet switched and circuit switched network nodes, i.e., two infrastructures in parallel. This means that in 4G, traditional voice calls are replaced by IP telephony.
Dear viewers, and with the latest in the world of technology, we come to the end of today's edition of Cairo Local Time. I'm Sheena Adel. Thank you for watching.